Good morning. Would you pray with me this morning? Lord, this day is yours. We've assembled to praise your name and to seek your will in our lives. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable and pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. As Kathy mentioned, our pastors are away this Sunday. My name is Rich Hoy. My wife and I have been members here for 29 years. So I guess we've been around the block. What a crazy world we've lived in these past 15 months. For me, like many of you, this ride started March of last year. I was sitting at my desk typing an email when one of the office managers walked up and told me that I needed to pack up my laptop and head home to work. He told me it would probably be for about 3 weeks. I told him okay and continued to type the email I was in the middle of composing. He stood there and he said, "I mean now." I apparently failed to grasp the urgency of the need to clear the office. That was almost 15 months ago, and to this day, my coworkers and I, those of us with laptops, have not been allowed to go back in our office. Signs were posted on the doors advising visitors that they were not welcome until the threat of COVID had passed. I heard last week that we may be able to come back in July. We'll see. You might think I would say that I didn't deserve to be treated like this. How about back in 2009 when I lost my job? I went over a year looking for work without finding it. We had to sell our house and move to a smaller place that we could afford on my wife's income. We didn't deserve that, did we? What about the time I loaded 3 snowmobiles onto a trailer after some family snowmobiling back in 2004? If you look at that back snowmobile, the skis are sticking out just a little bit past the edge. I managed to get pinned at the Mackinac Bridge toll booth, blocking the toll lane. I had to get out and tell the people in the lane behind me that they would have to move to another lane. A police officer came over and told me he had to measure the load on the trailer since I had shut down the toll lane, and the result of his measuring was I was cited for being over width. I would have to either change the way the snowmobiles were loaded on the trailer, or I could drop the trailer there at the toll booth and come back for it later when I could do that. It was 7 degrees outside, and my wife needed to stay in the van with our 2 small children while I tried to rearrange the snowmobiles in a way that would allow us to continue on our trip home. What did I do to deserve that? So where does God fit into all of this? How could God allow something like this to happen to us? Merriam-Webster defines deserve as a verb to be worthy of, or to be worthy, fit, or suitable for some reward or requital. So you deserve it means you've earned something. Whether or not the meaning is positive or negative depends on the context, though. Some examples, you've been working so hard, take a break, you deserve it. Or, did you see how he was driving? He deserved what he got. So what do we truly deserve? Is there a place in Scripture that might clear this up? I'd like to ask Kathy to read our Scripture passage for this morning.
Romans 1:28-32. Furthermore, just as they did not think it worthwhile to retain the knowledge of God, so God gave them over to a depraved mind, so that they do what ought not to be done. They have become filled with every kind of wickedness, evil, greed, and depravity. They are full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, and malice. They are gossips, slanderers, God-haters, insolent, arrogant, and boastful. They invent ways of doing evil. They disobey their parents. They have no understanding, no fidelity, no love, no mercy. Although they know God's righteous decree that those who do such things deserve death, they not only continue to do these things, but also approve of those who practice them. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Kathy. Earlier in this chapter, Paul refers to all the godlessness and wickedness of people who suppress the truth by their wickedness, since what may be known about God is plain to them because God has made it plain to them. And Paul further states, for although they knew God, they neither glorified him as God nor gave thanks to him, but their thinking became futile and their foolish hearts were darkened. Although they claimed to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images made to look like a mortal human being and birds and animals and reptiles. Here's where things get kind of tough for me. These passages, they're talking about me. As a young man, I was filled with every kind of wickedness. I was filled with evil, filled with greed. I lived in depravity. I was full of envy. In a very real sense, with regard to someone's eternal life, I was guilty of murder. I caused strife. I was deceitful. I practiced malice. I was definitely guilty of gossip. I slandered others. And by not being an obedient follower of Jesus, I was a God-hater. I was insolent. I was arrogant. And I bragged about it. With my friends, I invented ways of doing evil. I showed little or no understanding. I could not be kept in confidence. I did not understand love. I was pretty slim on mercy. So what does this passage about me, say I deserve? God's righteous decree is that those who do such things deserve death. I deserve death. This is what I deserve. This is what I earned. This death is an eternal separation from God. Romans 6:23 begins, "For the wages of sin is death." There are a lot of descriptions in the Bible regarding this fate, and I'm pretty sure I'm not alone in earning it. Romans 3:23 states, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." We're all part of this. I don't know of anyone who, by his or her own acts, are exempt from this fate. So what is this death? I believe it's eternal separation from God. Luke 13 describes it like this: "There will be weeping there and gnashing of teeth when you see Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and all the prophets of the kingdom of God, but you yourselves thrown out." Jesus talks about this in his explanation of the parable of the weeds in Matthew 13. "As the weeds are pulled up and burned in the fire, so it will be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send out his angels, and they will weed out of his kingdom everything that causes sin and all who do evil. They will throw them into the blazing furnace, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." And Revelation 20 describes this fate by stating, "Anyone whose name was not found written in the book of life was thrown into the lake of fire." So, now I know what I truly deserve. But wait, I also know the prescription for avoiding it. The full verse in Romans 6:23 is this: "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord." And I think we all know John 3:16 and 17: "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him." Jesus suffered and died that I might avoid this fate. Jesus took my sins upon himself and allowed himself to be nailed to a cross. There's nothing I did to earn this redemption. There's nothing I did to deserve this salvation. Other than accepting Christ as my Lord and Savior and having my name listed in the Book of Life, there's nothing I can do that will save me from being thrown into the lake of fire. Now that I am redeemed through Jesus' blood, I can walk away from my past life. I am no longer bound to it. I am truly free. I would like to think that all the things I did to deserve death are behind me. To a large extent, they are. But I still fall short on a daily basis, and I still cling to the cross. Paul had the same struggle. He referenced it in Romans 7. So I find this law at work. Although I want to do good, evil is right there with me. For in my inner being, I delight in God's law. But I see another law at work in me, waging war against the law of my mind and making me a prisoner of the law of sin at work within me. What a wretched man I am. Who will rescue me from this body that is subject to death? Thanks be to God, who delivers me through Jesus Christ our Lord. And just as there is reality in my sinful nature, there's also the real need for me not to fall back in my sinful ways. Paul points this out in Romans 6. What shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? By no means. We are those who have died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? Or don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. So, by learning the truth and by accepting new life through Christ, we are no longer bound to sin and we are able to live life in abundance. This realization has changed my outlook. I now see good in things that occur around me, and good is what I don't deserve. I have an amazing wife and two incredible daughters. I don't deserve them. I live in a cool house on a dirt road with a lawn full of cottonwood. I don't deserve that. I had three meals yesterday, and I've already had breakfast today, and I didn't deserve them. Wait a minute, I didn't deserve breakfast? I deserve death. I know what I deserve. Every meal is a gift. My snowmobile trailer story actually occurred after I accepted Christ, and even then I could see good in the situation. We were totally exposed right by the Straits of Mackinac, but there was no wind, there was no snow, it was clear and sunny. I had no help to move the sledge around, but I had the strength to do it myself. It took about an hour, but I did it. And later in the trip, we went through construction in the Saginaw area with very narrow lanes and construction barriers. And it occurred to me that if the skis of that sled on the back had still been hanging over the edge, they very well may have caught on one of the barriers and either damaged the sled or maybe even pulled it off the trailer in traffic. A lot of good came out of my mishap at the bridge toll. Good that I did not deserve. It's my prayer that none of you get what you deserve. It's my prayer that you find true faith in Christ, faith that sets you free from sin, and faith that enables you to see things in a different light. Knowing the truth of Jesus' saving grace and knowing the truth of what you actually deserve can promote a powerful change in your outlook. May each of you see your reality in this light. Amen and amen.